Okay, in this video, we're going to look at the concept of HIDE or hypothetical document embeddings. And this comes from the paper called Precise Zero-Shot Dense Retrieval Without Relevance Labels. So remember, dense retrieval is just looking up things with a similarity search or a semantic search, usually with a vector store nowadays involved here. So this paper came out at the end of last year. It's one that I kind of feel like not enough people have paid attention to. It's a technique that, while it's very simple, is very powerful in the way that you can improve your RAG system overall. So if we look at this diagram from the paper, this shows you the fundamentals of how this thing works. And this is that we're going to input a query into our system. And then rather than straight away just look up the embedding for that, and compare that embedding to all the possible chunks to find the best answer, we're actually going to use a large language model in the middle. And what that large language model in the middle is going to do is write a hypothetical answer. So why would you use this? Let me explain this. Sometimes if someone asks a question that's very bland, or often that perhaps doesn't have any nouns in it or any things that we can easily look up to find an answer, that can be quite challenging. So if we look at the example of McDonald's, right? We all know the concept of, what does McDonald's sell? It sells food. But if someone's asked the question, okay, what are McDonald's best items? Now, if I ask you that question, there's a high probability that you will know that I'm talking about food, and that perhaps I'm talking about burgers or shakes or fries, or the type of fast food that is. The challenge is, none of that is mentioned in the query. So if I'm taking an embedding of the query and I'm then looking up an embedding of something else, and let's say I didn't mention the word McDonald's. Maybe we've been talking about McDonald's and I just say, oh, okay, what are their best-selling items? Now, best-selling items plus, you know, looking for Big Macs in our semantic vector store, the chances of finding it's probably going to be reasonably small. So in this case, one of the best ways to do this is to have the language model write an answer first. Now, we're writing the answer not to let the end user ever see the answer. We're writing the answer just to get something which we can then take an embedding from. So, for example, if the large language model writes the answer and it says, oh, you know, their best-selling item is Big Mac, or their best-selling item is the Tuesday burger or something like that, even if it's the wrong answer, you'll notice that it's talked about a burger, it's talked about McDonald's, it's talked about stuff now, which when we take an embedding of that, will be a good representation to look up and find the right answer. So this allows you to do something where you're not doing query to answer embedding similarity, we're doing answer to answer embedding similarity. And it turns out that this often works really well. Now, it doesn't always work well. If you're talking about a topic that the language model has no knowledge of at all remotely, you probably want to stay away from this because it will tend to hallucinate things that are totally different. And I'll show you an example of that in the notebook. But on the whole, if you're dealing with something where you need to look up something that's going to be quite specific, it can often be quite good to have the language model do this. Now, one of the other things it can do is, rather than just generate one answer, you can generate multiple answers, and then you can feed those into, you know, you can average those out in an embedding model. So you can take an embedding of each of those and average them out, which will allow you then to basically look up things as well. So there are a number of different ways you can sort of use this, but it is a very powerful technique for this. Let's jump into the code and have a look at how this actually works in the code. So remember that the HIDE is hypothetical document embeddings. And the idea is that we're going to create a hypothetical answer with a large language model. And then we're going to embed that and use that for the search against our documents in our RAG here. So, okay, we can see that the code part to do this is, we need some base embeddings or base embedding model, and we need an LLM chain. And you'll see that we'll change the prompts. We've got some basic prompts in there, but we'll also then go for some custom prompts as we go through this. All right, so you can see what I'm bringing in here. I'm using OpenAI just for simplicity for the large language model. For embeddings, I'm going to be using the BGE embeddings. And you'll see that as we go through that this is going to be generating out the embeddings. You could swap this out for any embedding system that you wanted to use, which would be fine. Even if you were using like a local system, you could use the quantized embeddings for this in here. All right, so this is where the magic sort of starts. So you can see that we're going to get the embeddings out of this, but actually what we're doing is making a chain in here. So this is from large language model chain. We're passing in the actual embedder that we've set up here. So we've set up our BGE embeddings. And what this is going to do is this going to take in our query. And you can see that when we look at the prompt for this, we can see that, okay, what's it going to do? Please write a passage to answer the question. So this is a very simple sort of example. You'll see later on that it's often good for us to write this and customize it to our particular use case in this. But okay, we can see what we've got there. Let me just sort of go through and explain again what I talked about earlier on, was that something like, what items does McDonald's make? Now, we know that McDonald's makes food and it makes burgers and it makes fries and things like that. But you'll notice that none of those things are mentioned in the query. So this is where, if we're taking an embedding of the query versus the answers back, it might not be a great thing because, you know, the answers we would want back would be French fries, Big Mac, that kind of thing. But none of those are mentioned in the actual query. So here, the large language model, and I've just turned on LangChain, you know, debugging here so that we can see the output of every step. We can see that it goes into the large language model. It basically says, write an answer to this. The answer that OpenAI writes is, McDonald's is a fast food chain which is known for making a variety of things. These include signature burgers such as Big Mac, Quarter Pounder, as well as chicken sandwiches, wraps, desserts. We've got a lot more stuff now that's content that the embedding would fit this. So something like Big Mac is mentioned in there. Now, when it's going through looking for pieces of text, it's probably going to match things that are Big Mac related in there. So that's the first way and the simplest way to do it, with just their built-in prompt, that kind of thing. The next way we can do this is we can also have multiple generations. So rather than just generate one answer, we can generate multiple answers. So here you can see, you know, when we ask it, okay, what is McDonald's best-selling item? Again, we're not mentioning, actually, we're not even mentioning food here, right? So if we're just doing the query sort of lookup, it's possible that it could get confused of not knowing that, okay, we're actually talking about food. Whereas the large language model kind of gets it. Even if it's not giving us the exact right answer, it's giving us, oh, McDonald's is one of the most popular fast food restaurants in the world. Its menu items include a variety of items, but one stands out is the bestseller, the Big Mac, right? And we can see that we've got different answers in here. Best-selling item is undoubtedly the Big Mac. And we've got, you know, a number of different, we got Big Mac mentioned again here. So when we take the embeddings of these and we combine them, we're definitely going to get this representation of Big Mac coming through for when we do our search with that embedding there. So this is one of the key things that makes Hyde so powerful, right? Is that you could take a number of these things, combine these embeddings. Another thing that you could also do is use your own prompt. So if I don't want a long answer like that back, and I just want it to mention the food, I can say, okay, please answer the user's question as a single food item. So now I kind of know, I would use this in a case where I kind of know what the question is going to be about or the topic, and I would guide the LLM to that topic. So if we were doing this for the McDonald's website, you know, we could put in there, you are a helpful assistant that works for McDonald's. You answer questions about different things on the menu. Please answer this by recommending a single food item, kind of thing in there. So now when somebody just says, oh, what is McDonald's best selling item? Or even worse in this case is where people would just say, oh, what's your best selling item? Right now, what's your best selling item doesn't even have McDonald's in it for the embedding. That wouldn't go down well. Whereas we can see that if we've set up this user prompt quite well, we can get something back, which then in this case, we just wanted a single item. What did it return? Big Mac. We can take our embedding on Big Mac. There's our embedding for Big Mac. And then we could do a search on it for this kind of thing. So just quickly to show you how to put it all together. So in the original example, they were just using a single file. I've brought in some text loaders in here. And what I'm going to do is ask it. Now, I've got two examples here, one that's not here, one that I am showing here. So let me show the one that works here first. And this is, you know, please answer the user's questions related to large language models. Again, we're guiding it with a custom prompt here. I'm going to ask, okay, what are chat loaders? It kind of makes something up that's wrong, right? Chat loaders are software tools used to load large language models into chatbot applications. And that's not quite right. But it doesn't matter because it's mentioned all the key things so that the representation is able to then find these chat loaders so that we can, you know, we can come in here and we can look at this article, chat loaders, fine-tune our chat model in your own voice in here, you know, for doing this. So this is an example of how it would, you know, it would work. You'd have to be a little bit careful. So originally I was going to do the example of Langsmith, like I've done in some of the other notebooks. The challenge there was that the large language model knows nothing about what Langsmith was. So unless I was to overly guide it in my question prompt, it came back saying that, oh, well, it's language learning software. So you want to be careful for if it's something that's totally new that the language model's perhaps never heard of, you know, then you want to be a little bit careful about using Hide. But for other situations, using Hide is often going to get you better results than just embedding the query and doing the query against the answer sort of similarity match there. So this is a very powerful technique. I encourage you to check it out and try it out on your own projects and see how you get along. As always, if you've got questions, please put them in the comments below. If you found the video useful, please click like and subscribe, and I will talk to you in the next video. Bye for now.